seemed like the perfect night for leaving. Hello, welcome to the Don Ellis Gatlin Show. That's me. And we're going to start out with the incredible song from the Everly Brothers. Dream when I want you in my arms, when I want you in all your charms, whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream when I feel blue in the night, when I need you to hold me tight, whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream. Guitar, Josh Berkheimer on the drums, David Abdo on the bass, Jay Smith on acoustic guitar for now. And folks, we have an amazing special guest tonight. I'm so excited. I'm a huge fan of this gentleman. He's accomplished so much in his career, and he's still rocking. Might be hotter than ever right now. Our special guest is here, Mr. Ronnie McDowell. We're going to get him up here right now.
Alive and in color.
Yes, that's right. You're on this now. You're on the talking mic right there.
Oh, okay. All right. And I'm going to put my phone
cheat sheet.
Right here. Cheat sheet, yes.
A very advanced cheat sheet.
That's right. And I love this because I showed you guys a new invention tonight.
I love
on
that.
On the back of my phone. You need to get this. Unbelievable. Because I can become Ronnie McDowell and then go straight into Ben Franklin.
Its glasses are inside the phone.
Well, it's in the back.
That's pretty cool.
And the guy that
kind of James Bond-ishy.
Oh, it's unbelievable. And the cool thing about it is, let me show you.
Okay.
They work both ways. So I literally become Ben Franklin.
I love that. Yeah. I love that.
So anyway, I'm going to use that on a new song tonight that I have on social media. And we just charted with it. And it's so relevant, called Sure Could Use a Little Good News Today. And
we're
good,
we're
going
to get to all that, Ronnie, because you're on fire right now. You're on fire right now.
Yeah,
I
just.
What's going on?
Yeah, hey, Don, I just signed a new record deal.
I can't complete your story.
With Siri?
So I just signed a new record deal
with Turn Records. Yeah. And
my
record company president Mike Kern said, you know, you're the only 70-year-old besides Tony Bennett that has signed a record deal. And I said,
that's incredible.
I said, now,
first of all, you don't look nowhere near that.
I said, no way. Thank you. I said,
but wait a minute. He's 94.
He is. He's amazing too.
Oh, unbelievable.
He's incredible.
I saw him at the Beau Rivage. I snuck in and I saw
him. It was just him and a piano. He was 87 then.
Right.
And I'm telling you, it was unbelievable.
And that's where you had the restraining order against you.
No, he didn't have that.
But I did get to sneak in
and see him. And I'm a big Tony Bennett fan.
I remember not too long ago,
Joel did that big Shea Stadium opening.
Yeah.
And Tony Bennett was one of his guests, and he sang New York State of Mind.
Tore
the house down, just 100,000 people, that's all.
Yeah, and you know, when I'm doing my paintings, now a lot of you folks don't know this, but I paint. I'm a painter. I've been with the Disney Corporation for 6 years now. But
I'm talking about it for everybody.
Yeah, and I paint all of my friends, like Dolly Parton. She and I have a new duet on my new album. A song that she wrote. Unbelievable. I can't wait till you hear this.
That's what I'm saying. You have so much going on. But I want to go back to the beginning.
Okay, let's go back.
I want to go back. We'll get to all that.
Okay.
But I'm going back to the beginning. First of all, where did this all start for you? When do you get this talent? And where did you know you had this talent to sing and perform?
In 1953, you're not going to believe this, but in Portland, Tennessee, I was walking around the house at 3 years old, and I sent me a C. I want to show you boys what I was singing. I swear to you, at 3 years old, I was going, "Your cheating heart." I was singing Hank Williams at 3 years old, and he is still my ultimate country icon.
Oh.
Point blank, period. That's it.
I don't know where country would be without him. I mean, this guy was the first major singer-songwriter. He was unbelievable.
That was it. And if you listen to Hank today, all of y'all, if you listen to Your Cheating Heart or "Today I Passed You on the Street and my heart fell at your feet." Hey, doesn't that sound like a sloppy transplant?
I never thought of it, but yes, it really does.
But anyway, Hank Sr., my ultimate country hero.
I guess the next one would have to be George Jones.
Oh, yeah.
Who was my friend of 40 years.
And I heard that the great George Jones, though, when he
came out in the Opry, someone said, "Hey, listen, we already have a Hank Williams. You need to come up with your own style."
Well,
it's hard to believe now that George was emulating Hank Williams.
But if you think about this, success
breeds imitation. So Baron Young, if you listen to his records, the very first, sounded just like Hank Williams. If you, Ray Price sounded like, you know, everybody has to draw from somewhere. They all
that's
did.
A good one.
But we all do.
Yeah,
we
absolutely. Do that. Hey, when the Beatles came out, you during rehearsal, you were singing Paul McCartney.
That's right. Actually, I heard McCartney
in the Wings because growing up, the first records I heard were actually Paul and the Wings. And then I went back and heard all those amazing Beatle records.
Yeah. And, you know, in 1964, when I was 14 and the Beatles hit, I never will forget this.
Perfect age.
Yeah, I know. I was 14 and the Beatles came out with, here's what I love. There is so much beauty in simplicity.
Yeah.
So when I heard "I Want to Hold Your Hand," I mean, how simple can that get?
Yeah.
But how beautiful it was.
Yeah.
Those guys had magic. Yes. Paul and John, they were just magic.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Elvis to me is, you know, as I've told you before,
well,
he's my favorite singer of all time.
Well, he's my ultimate icon.
Yes. Well, I'm getting to that. Now you...
Okay.
I want to thank you also for your service.
Oh,
I don't know if people know this, but you were in the Navy.
Well, now, let me tell you this. Okay, October the 26th, 1968, I landed in Saigon. I am a three-term combat veteran of the Vietnam War.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
My goodness gracious.
Yep.
Did you sing for any of your fellow soldiers? Like
now, here's the weird part.
Sing for them guys?
Now, let me tell you this. This is so weird how fate works. Fate is a hunter. That's the truth. So, the first time I ever sang in front of anybody, think about this, was on the USS Hancock. It was just service people, right? I never sang in front of anybody because I was so shy. But me and Chuck Nitsche and Joe Hedgepeth, I'm not getting dementia because I can still remember these guys.
Right.
So, let me tell you this. This old man grabbed my arm just before I stepped on stage, and he goes, come here. He goes, hey, where are you going to stand right there? Elvis Presley stood right there in 1956. I said, yeah, right. He said, I was there. Lo and behold, on the USS Hancock.
The performance he did.
With the Heartbreak Hotel is exactly where I stood for the first time ever sang
you didn't even
in my
know
life.
It.
Let me tell you what I sang. And I didn't know it, I do now.
Yeah.
But let me tell you what I sang. This is where fate will find you. Fate is a hunter. Because I've been Elvis's voice now in 12 movies.
I know
a
it.
Twilight Zone episode.
I know it.
And so this is the first thing I ever sang in my life. Well, when my blue moon turns to gold again. An
wow.
Elvis Presley song.
You sounded just like him just then.
Wow. Oh, okay. But anyway,
I was like, whoa, wait a minute.
First thing I ever sang in my life was an Elvis song, Where He Stood Right There. Boy, the irony has kept going on. Do you know who Elvis Presley's grandfather is? I'm going to tell you. Jesse D. McDowell. What's my name?
McDowell.
Okay.
So you're
if you don't believe me, check it
so
out.
So you just, are...
just Google. I'm not saying that. You
but
never
it's possible.
Know what, you never know what monkey's in the woodpile.
It's possible.
But... but... Elvis's grandfather is Jesse D. McDowell. How cool
wow,
can that,
that
be?
That is very cool.
Yeah, it is. You didn't know that, did
well,
you?
Well, I have the Gatlin name, and
I know.
And so I was at the backstage of Grand Ole Opry one night.
Yep.
And Dwayne Allen from the Oak Ridge Boys.
Yep.
We were sitting back here just hanging out talking, and he looks at me, and goes, "So are you related?" And I just knew he was going to say Larry. You know, because
yeah.
Are you related to Smitty Gatlin? No one's ever asked me before that.
Now, who is Smitty?
Smitty is the founder of the Oak Ridge Boys. He's one of the founding members of the Oak Ridge Boys.
I didn't
no
know
one's
that.
Ever asked. I just knew he was going to say, Larry went, are you late to Smitty? That was incredible. Speaking of incredible, we lost Elvis in 1977.
Yep.
It was a big, big loss. I mean, I remember the day, plain as day. And I was only 8 or 9 years old.
Oh.
I remember it. We came home from the grocery store. And they announced on the TV, the king is gone. And I went, that's got to be some king, some countries they're talking about. They're not talking about Elvis.
Right.
And they were talking about Elvis, of course. And then you came out with a song that you wrote.
Yep.
And I remember playing that scene, you sounded exactly like Elvis on that particular song. And you wrote this song. And this song is sold.
6 million, maybe more now. But at the time I looked at it, this was a while back. 6 million copies of this song. It's the soul.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. And it really, it was a time that the Elvis had the biggest fan base in the world. And it really was a
healing, helping moment for everybody. I remember that time. And that was like, everybody could just kind of mourn together. And that song, I think, brought everybody together. Drawing it out.
Thank you for that song.
Well, thank you. And, remember what I said, fate is a hunter, right? So the next day after Elvis died, you don't know this, but I went to Memphis. I stood in line from 8:30 till 5 o'clock. I still don't know how my bladder held up. But anyway, I stood in line all that time. This is God's truth. I got from here to that glass right there.
And they closed the gates. I didn't get in. So on the way back to Nashville... Never will forget this. Turned the radio on and said, well, we've opened up the gates now. Well, remember what I told
right,
you?
Right.
So a friend of mine said, well, Ronnie, here's the deal. Think about this. Had you got in to see Elvis's body lying in state, I never laid eyes on Elvis, but I'm still his biggest fan. He said that would have taken you 2 to 3 hours to go. You know how far the driveway is up to Graceland. Well, he said, you would not be standing in Scorpion Records when you got back
to Nashville, and Lee Morgan, who helped you write that song, would not have been standing there because it would have been too late.
Fate.
Fate is a hunter.
Yep.
So I never will forget 2 days later, we went in on that Friday. Elvis died on a Tuesday. And at Music City Recorders, which is now a parking lot, it's so sad to me.
And Scorpion Records, where were they based out of?
It was in the Columbia Records office.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes. And Music City Recorders, now here's another thing, where I recorded The King Is Gone was Elvis's guitar player, Scotty Moore's studio. Tell me the irony.
Unbelievable.
Right? The irony. Wow.
I tell you what's underrated. I think this was a single that came out. The King Was Gone was so big. I mean, this was a major pop hit.
Oh, yeah.
Major pop hit.
Yeah.
If I could be wrong, correct me if I'm wrong, but you had a song I thought was right after that. I love you, I love you, yeah. I love you.
That was a huge pop record.
You. Yeah. Please tell me, please tell me you love me too. Man, I love that song.
You sound like me doing that.
Well, I'm a fan. I said that song is awesome too.
Well, thank you. So I got to tell you now, that Friday, right, the record hit. I left the studio that night. And by the way, I want to tell you all this because this is the God's truth. I had no money. But Lee Morgan, who helped me write it, he said, hey, Ronnie, you got to pay for this. I ain't got no money. And he left the studio. I said, man, I ain't got but $42 to my name. He said, you got to pay for it. I wrote hot checks. True. I hate to tell you all this, but I did.
We're getting some inside stuff here. I love it. Yes. I love it.
For the studio, for the studio, for the musicians, the tape, you know what it amounted to in 1977? $2,800. You know how much money that was? I was so frightful and scared to death. So I went home. I slept with that tape. It was about this big, about that thick, 24-track. So the next morning, I flew down to Nashville at the Monument Studios.
Oh, yeah, Monument.
Which is so cool. It's still there. And I'm sitting on the steps. The steps are still there. And so here's the irony. Here comes this young lady. Well, she was, you know, middle-aged lady. And she goes, Ronnie, what are you doing here? I said, Gail, I think I got a hit. She said, what is it? I said, I need some acetates made. They were about this big. You could only play them for so much, so long, before they'd wear out. $8 a piece. I said, I want 8 of them. She said, well, come on up. You know who that was? Scotty Moore's girlfriend.
Look at ding. That's incredible.
So I left that studio with 8 acetates, and I went over to Weno Radio in Madison. Why I stopped there, I don't know. It was a little AM station. 1 mile.
Back when DJs would play the record. It was, wasn't all animated.
1 mile from Colonel Tom Parker's house.
Yeah.
So I walked in and I said, would y'all play this? And the girl behind the counter said, well, we just don't do that. I said, well, it's about Elvis. She said, well, hold on a minute. She took one of the acetates and went behind a glass like that. And I saw the DJ, and he said, come here. He said, you stand right here. I'm going to play this. And I said, you're kidding. He started playing it, Don. I swear to God. And when it got about a fourth into it, his phone line lit up.
The phones were, I had to be lit up.
No, it lit up. And he goes, damn, something's wrong with my phone.
it's a Dewey Cox moment.
And it never stopped.
Oh, my gosh.
For the 3 hours. So then.
I believe. I remember that record was unbelievable.
Oh, this ain't the end of it. So then I felt like I was on top of the world. I went to the big pop station up in the Stallman building.
Yeah.
WLAC, the number one pop station. I told them same story. She goes, well, we're the number one pop station. We don't do anything like that.
Right.
I said, what's about Elvis? Let me tell you what went on. She said, well, hold on a minute. There were 3 guys standing in the hallway. I could tell he did the same thing. He took it and listened to it, and he said, come here. I said, what's going on? He said, you stand right here. I'm going to play it. Number one pop station. Yeah. He come back out 3 minutes later, and he goes, you have tied our phone lines up. You got a monster. You know who that was? John Conley. He was the program director.
John Conley?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
Where's the irony in that?
Oh, my gosh. I love John Conley.
So then the next night, they wanted me on the Grand Ole Opry.
That quick, boom, boom. It's a Dewey Cox moment.
Yeah. The next night. So I'm standing backstage, and I'm tapping the wall, and here comes Jim Ed Brown. And he puts love his you, arm around you. Me, and he goes, son, you're going to be fine. I said, Mr. Brown, I'm not afraid to sing. I just wrote this song, and I don't know this song. He said, when did you write it, son? I said, 2 days ago.
2 days ago.
He said, well, good luck, son.
That sounds like Jim Edwards.
But I want you
know. Well, good luck.
I want you to know I never missed a syllable.
Oh, my God.
So gosh. Elvis or somebody was hanging out with me.
That is incredible. And that's the showbiz stories that, you know, that's a Hollywood movie. It really is. You don't hear that and, like, we discourage people when they come to town, they think that stuff like that happens, which obviously did happen to you for real.
Yes.
But you know, overall, we tell people to get off the bus, you know, come to Nashville. It's like, yeah. It doesn't happen like that.
Right.
You're not going to walk in a studio, play your record, and then next thing you know, 2 days later, you're in the Grand Ole Opry.
Right.
It doesn't happen. But for you, it did happen.
It did.
And the thing, I've said this before to you, Ronnie, I think this is the most unique thing and incredible thing that shows your talent, is that you had this thing. You sounded exactly like Elvis on that record, and it was a great song.
But now, when we recorded it, Lee Morgan, who helped me write it,
because
I wrote all the first part. I was barely 6 years old when I first heard him sing.
Yeah.
I wrote all of that, and he wrote the singing part. We combined it together, but he came over to me. We were just kind of, we didn't know what we were doing. We were fumbling in the dark at Studio 19.
Right.
He goes, hey, I've come to see you at the Country Godfather on Lebanon Road. And when you do an Elvis song, you kind of sound like Elvis. You need to do this like Elvis. And I said, I don't want to do it like Elvis.
That's what I was getting to. The thing that's amazing is that you had this incredible hit that you sound like Elvis on. I've never seen anybody else, I mean it, in the history of music, do what you've done. You had this amazing hit sounding like someone else, our hero, Elvis Presley. But then you go, yeah, but I'm Ronnie McDowell.
That's why.
And I'm going to go get a record deal doing my music the way I sing. And I've never seen anybody pull that off but you. I can't think of anybody in the history of music do that.
But I
can't anybody.
But for the last 5 years, I had written songs for Roy Drusky, the Wilburn Brothers, Billy Walker, Jeannie Shepherd.
You were laying the foundation
Porter
down.
Wagner.
You were laying the foundation
So
down.
The last thing I wanted to do was do a record that sounded like Elvis, even though I was his biggest fan.
But you the pressure, though, you
I
had
know.
To have when that happened. But you went in there. Was it Buddy Killen that you
No. Oh, it's way before
way
Buddy for,
Way before Buddy. So who was you signed with? What was your first label? Was it
Scorpion
Sony?
Scorpion Records.
Scorpion,
Slim
then to
Williamson.
Sony? Then it went to Sony?
Scorpion, then Epic.
Then Epic Records.
Yes.
Which I was also on.
Yep.
We were label mates. Come on.
Yep.
You were on there a lot longer than I was, though. A lot more success than I had. But you start putting out your own music.
Yes.
And pretty quickly in the game, you had a number one record on Epic Records.
Yep.
And then I got to do a shout out. You have a huge fan who's like, this is her favorite song. Marilyn is her name.
Hey,
She's
Marilyn.
Watching tonight in Florida.
Hey,
and
Marilyn.
She
love
loves
you,
this song. And she was so excited when she found out you were going to be on my show. And she said, oh, please, please, I hope he does older women. Because that's her favorite.
And I want to tell y'all, I just did the Ray Stevens show, and the producer grabbed my arm.
That show's not as good as ours.
Well, but here's what I want to tell you. Just before I went out, the producer said, Ronnie, whatever you do, talk a lot, because we can't get nobody to talk when they come on here. I said, man, I ain't got no problem with that.
You said that
So Ray Stevens, he leaned back halfway through the interview, and he goes, you sure do talk a lot. I said, Ray, the producer told me to talk a lot. And he goes, yeah, but you talk a lot.
No, this is great. I'm loving it. I think we'll get some exclusive stuff about you. I didn't even know about it. I've been a big fan for a long time.
Oh,
and I've heard some things just already in this show that I did not know.
Well, good.
I love it. But I do know this was a number one song in the nation. Can you do it for us? A little older women.
Yes.
Marilyn, here it comes.
Older women are beautiful lovers. Said older women,
they understand.
Yes, they do. I've been around some, and I have discovered that older women know just how to please a man. Everybody seems to love those younger women. From 18 on up to 25,
mama,
I love them too. But I'm telling you, learning how to really love takes a little time.
Older women are beautiful lovers.
A beautiful lover.
Older women,
they
understand.
They do, don't they, honey? I've
discovered.
Don't you know that older women know just how to please a man?
Boy, they sure do, don't they, Don?
I agree completely.
Older women.
Honey, don't you worry about getting older. Those young girls, they ain't got one thing on you, mama. That's right. cause it takes a living to get good at giving. Giving love is just where you could teach them a thing or two.
Older women,
our beautiful lover,
a beautiful loving
older women,
they understand.
Honey, check.
I've been around some,
and
I have discovered,
don't you know that older women
know just how to please a man.
And older men are grateful.
Ronnie McDowell, everybody.
Come on.
Woo! We are live and in color.
That's right. Ronnie, you mentioned earlier about the amazing soundtracks you've done. The one that started it off, I think, was one of my favorite actors. It was a big moment in his career, too, Mr. Kurt Russell, because he had been the big Disney go-to kid star.
That's
and
right.
And then he got the lead playing Elvis in the movie that everybody watched, and everybody thought that was Elvis singing, including me. Wait a minute here. The track sounds a little different. The track is only the part that fooled. The voice didn't. I mean, everyone thought that was Elvis.
Yeah.
The only thing that made it like that might not be Elvis, it was not you, it was the track was different on some of those things, you know.
Well, I got to tell you, you know, Kurt Russell told me, he goes, Ronnie, he said, I got to tell you, Elvis made me a star. I said, Kurt, you were already a Disney star.
Yeah.
He said, Ronnie, my next movie was Escape from New York. They paid me 20 grand.
I mean,
20 million.
I'm a big John Carpenter guy. And Kurt Russell did all those movies. Yep.
I said, 20 million? He goes, Elvis made me a star.
Love it. Love it.
And then I did a movie with Priscilla Presley, and she and I are still the best of friends. I just seen her not long ago. And everywhere I go, everybody goes, what's she like?
Yep.
And I go, damn if I know, but I know what she don't like because I tried that.
That had to be meeting her, and like people that you've been around, the Elvis's band, the original band, the band that you've worked with, the band that he toured with the Vegas years on through the touring years in the 70s. Yeah. You've worked with all those guys. You're a big part of the Graceland gathering that I know they've done.
Yeah.
You're a big part of the family. I think they consider you a big part of the family, don't you think?
From what I've seen. Well, I hope so.
I think so.
But I got to tell you that Red West was one of my best friends in the whole wide world. George Klein, Elvis's best friend.
Disc jockey, famous disc jockey.
Yeah. George just passed away. He and I were friends. Think about this. This is the crazy thing about life. George and I were friends for 42 years. How long did Elvis live? 42 years. Think about that.
Yeah.
How short life is. Yeah. But anyway, George said in 1948, Elvis came to Humes Junior High. He was only 12 years old. It was seventh grade. Well, he came in with his guitar. And George said, the teacher said, so Elvis, do you play that guitar? Yes, ma'am. Do you sing? Yes, ma'am. Would you sing us a song? So Elvis sang, Old Shep. When I was a lad, and Old Shep was a pup. Which I did in the Kurt Russell movie.
That's right.
So I never will forget this. George said, so every time a teacher asked him to sing, he would sing Old Shep. So George said, I finally went up to him and said, hey, man, don't you know another damn song?
Yes. Oh, my gosh. This is great.
But
oh, my
goodness. You know, you can only hear these stories from.
I got one for you.
Okay, go ahead.
I bet you've never talked about before.
What?
But you were there.
Okay.
We're talking about some huge, the biggest stars in the history of music.
Okay.
You actually did a TV show with, you got the Elvis, you got the Beatles.
Yep.
Probably in third place of all time is Mr. Michael Jackson.
I knew you were going
to
say that.
And you had hit after hit, so you were invited to be, I think you were a presenter on that particular show.
Well, I was, and I will tell you what happened. Dick Clark produced the Kurt Russell movie. So he called me in 84 and he said, Ronnie, I'm flying you out to California tonight and you're going to give Michael Jackson his award for his Thriller album. Well, I'm the biggest Michael Jackson fan, right?
Yeah, that album is ridiculous.
I said, really? So when I get out there, Dick Clark, I never will forget this as long as I live. He said, so you know Charlie in the band? I thought he was talking about Charlie Daniels, right? Yeah. I said, yeah, of course I do. He said, well, come over here and say hi to him because you're going to go out and give them the award for Michael with them. So I went over there, and here's these four black dudes, right? And I said, he said, so, Ronnie, you know Charlie and the boys? And I said, no, I thought you was talking about Charlie Daniels. He said, Ronnie, Charlie and the Gap Band. And I went,
the Gap Band.
I love you. Dropped a bomb on me.
You dropped a bomb on me.
And
oh,
so
my God.
I said, no, Dick, I thought you was talking about Charlie Daniels. And he goes, well, say hi to Charlie. So I said hi to the guys, and I told him I loved him to death, which I do, still do. But Dick Clark looked at Charlie. This is the God's truth. This is what a good friend Dick Clark was to me. And he goes, Charlie, you guys are going out there with Ronnie, but Ronnie will be giving Michael Jackson his award. They looked at me with jaggers. I mean, because they were like, who in the hell is this guy? They didn't know me from Adam. But I knew them and I loved them.
Well, I knew you were, and I was watching that night, and it was the Michael Jackson award show.
Oh, yeah.
I think Kenny Rogers got one and Lionel Richie got one. All the other. Michael was so popular, he won Best Female that year.
Oh, yeah. But I never will forget Lionel Richie.
Yeah.
And I was so proud of this. He said, and I'm from Portland, Tennessee, by the way. Population 3,476, as I said, on Hee Haw in the cornfield with Roy Acuff. But anyway, I was so proud because Lionel Richie, who I love, I'm his biggest fan. He goes, and from Portland, Tennessee, Ronnie McDowell. And I opened that envelope. Now, here's what you don't know.
I want to hear it.
I opened that envelope, and I said, and the winner is Michael Jackson. So I held on to the envelope and laid it on the podium. Michael Jackson came up. He didn't even get the damn thing.
Thank you, Ronnie. Thank you, Ronnie. Good night, Ronnie. You're so sweet. I'll step aside, Ronnie. It's my show. Okay. That's my Michael Jackson.
Okay, so
I'm
really going to tell you what happened. I'm backstage, me and Conway Twitty. Conway was on the show that night. American Music Awards. Michael Jackson walked up to me first. True story. He goes, hi, how are you? Hello. And I went, fine, thank you.
Yes, I love it. I love it.
And then he walked over to Conway. I'm just going to tell y'all what happened. This is God's truth. He goes, Mr. Twitty, I have loved you all of my life.
Oh, that's nice.
And thank you so much for the music. And then he walked off. And Conway leaned over to me and he goes, Ronnie, I'm not really sure about him. That's what happened.
I got to tell you this. Now, Bruce Bowden, if you're out there watching, and this is a Ricky Skaggs story. Bruce told me they were at the Disney World. They're at Disney World, and Ricky was right in the middle of, you know, they were both on Epic Records. Michael was on Epic, all of us were. Ricky Skaggs on Epic Records.
Yeah.
So they're at Disney World, and Michael Jackson shows up. Bruce Bowden was telling me the story. He goes, and he shows up, and Ricky goes, oh, excuse me, guys, I'm gonna go over and say hi to Michael Jackson. And they're like, oh, good luck with that. he said, he walked over and he goes, hello, I'm Ricky Skaggs. We're label mates. Security. And my brother and I, one year we were nominated for, this is a true story too. My brother and I were nominated for Duo of the Year. And this particular award show. And we knew we were going to lose. Brooks had done one every time. We lost every time. But so we're sitting there, and my seats are right next to Liza Minnelli. I'm like, oh, my gosh, Liza Minnelli. So I have to say something. I said, you know, Miss Minnelli, I just want to say I'm a huge fan. It's just really cool to meet you. And she goes, oh, thank you so much. I just want to say that I'm a big fan of you, too. I went, what? She goes, that boot scootin' boogie is the cutest song I've ever heard. Now, of course, I'm not going to correct Miss Minnelli. I'm not going to correct her. Jesus. The whole show, I'm dreading when they go to the nominations. When they go to the nominations, like, she's going to realize that I went along with her being wrong. I'm like, oh, jeez. Please go to the bathroom or something during this part. But it was like.
Well, I'm glad you let me tell that Michael Jackson, Conway Twitty story.
Michael Jackson.
I know. Hey.
You shook his hand.
Yes.
Yes, yes. Hey, let's do another top 10 smash from Ronnie McDowell.
Which one?
Let's go. Let's watch some girls go by.
Oh, I want to tell you about this.
All right.
So, I never will forget, I was living in Portland, Tennessee, and I needed a follow-up to my number one record, Older Women Make Better Lovers. So I got all my old records out. Every song has a story.
Right.
So I got a 45. Remember this? Where are you going? Okay. So I never will forget, I heard this. And I went, wow. I'm a girl watcher.
Oh, yeah, the classic.
I'm a girl watcher. Watching girls go by.
Classic.
Me, oh, my. And I went, so I lifted Watching Girls Go By out of there. Now that song has been played over a million times on the radio. What's cool about it is this. When it reaches the million airplay, your royalties triple. So that's a really good thing.
I've not experienced that yet, Ronnie. Because what is aluminum? What's the status when you're at aluminum?
Cobalt.
So anyway, you didn't know this, but I actually wrote this for you and every boy in the band here. Are you ready?
Another song that Ronnie wrote, folks.
This is still your favorite pastime.
Let's do it. Let's do it. Savannah Jack, here we go.
Watching girls go by. Me, oh my, what a lovely way to spend the afternoon. Watching girls go by, that's how I spend my time. Picking out the ones I'd like to make love to.
Hey,
when I was just a boy, I put away my toys. I had been affected by the opposite sex and I had found my mouth. The water, those sweet young things were bad. A new pastime turned my head around. Watching girls go by, me, oh my, what a lovely way to spend the afternoon. Watching girls go by, that's how I spend my time. Picking out the ones I'd like to make love to.
I'll play that guitar,
Mr. Tony Hart.
Older, a little tame, but it's still the same old game. I am still attracted to those sexy lasses all around.
You too.
But I found what I've been needing. He don't just stand there dreaming. He's just comparing them to who he found.
Yeah, right.
Watching girls go by. Me, oh my, what a lovely way to spend the afternoon. Girls go by, that's how I spend my time. You're the only woman I'm gonna make love to. Watching girls go by, me, oh my, what a lovely way to spend the afternoon. Watching girls go by, that's how I spend my time. You're the only woman I'm gonna make love to. Yes, you're the only girl I'm gonna make love to.
Yes, you Woo! Are, mama!
Ronnie McDowell! In person, live!
You know what's cool about
Savannah
it?
Jack, band!
Yes, you boys sound good on that song. Thank you.
Yes.
He told me that y'all had a kicking band, and you do.
I appreciate that, sir. Wow. Thank you. I agree with that 100%.
Wow, I love it.
Another thing we mentioned early in the show,
yes.
But it's very, very awesome. Another major talent, your artwork, your paintings, the stuff that you're doing is absolutely incredible. It's on fire.
Yeah. You know, I'm so, and thank you very much.
That's true.
I'm so blessed. I've been so blessed all of my life. I started drawing in 1956 in the first grade. And my latest painting, I guess my latest one is... me and Dolly Parton have a new song on my new album.
That's a two-parter, though, isn't it?
Yes.
That's terrible. It's terrible. Terrible joke. Terrible joke.
I got it. I was dreaming last night when I was... I was dreaming last night. Dolly was my mama and I was nursing. Okay, all right.
That was a nightmare. I dreamed I was Dolly Parton was my mother and I was a bottle baby. I had a nightmare. Yeah.
I thought this was a family show.
I know, it is a family show. We'll put a big X on it.
So anyway, one of my latest paintings is Dolly and I were doing a new song that she wrote, and she said, I always wanted Elvis to sing. I will always love
you. I've heard that, yeah.
And she said, but he passed away. And I said, Dolly, he could have wore that song out. I mean, literally, think about it. And I will. I mean, he could have wore that song
That would have been a great record.
Out. But anyway, so I left the studio and I got to thinking, well, I'll paint Dolly and Elvis on a picnic in Sevierville and her singing it to him. And so I gave her the painting after I finished it. And she screamed and hollered, and she goes, oh, I got to tell you, Ronnie, if I was on a picnic with him, that's exactly how I would dress. You'd have to see the face.
That's awesome. She is one of the most incredible people that I've ever had the pleasure of meeting
in my life.
I was trying to think, you know, Garth Brooks has a really great quality about him that like, he makes you, he's such a presence, a star. He's just about as big a star. Again, he's in that top, you know, superstar status, but he makes you feel like a one-on-one personal thing really quickly.
Yeah.
And Dolly has that magic too. Dolly's always had that magic where Ronnie, I walked in on the studio by accident when she was doing a vocal. I wanted to die when I met her.
Yeah.
Rhonda Vincent, who's a great artist. She was recording. Dolly was doing the harmony of a vocal with her.
Right.
And Rhonda said, come over, it's my birthday. Come over and say, hey, it's my birthday. I said, sure, I'll be right over. I bust through the studio. Hey, my big mouth. Hey, Rhonda. And I looked up. Please God, tell me that's not Dolly right there doing a vocal. It was.
Oh, wow.
I interrupted her vocal. I was like, I wanted to die. So I went, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. And I said, you know, I came to see Rhonda, you know, it's her birthday. She goes, you didn't come to see me? You know, just totally flip it in. She's absolutely amazing.
Yeah, she's very humble and grounded.
How about you working with on your new duo project? This thing's going to be huge. You got Jerry Lee Lewis, another.
Oh, two.
I mean, come on now. Jerry Lee Lewis?
Jerry Lee and I did a song. He came into the studio. I got to tell y'all this. I was 36. He was 52. And he came in with a fifth of Jack Daniels. And he set it on the piano.
Doesn't sound like Jerry.
And he said, now, Killa, now, before we do your song, because I wrote a hit that we did called Never Too Old to Rock and Roll.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
I did not know you wrote that.
I did. So anyway, he comes in the studio, and he has this fifth of Jack Daniels. He said, now, Killa, before we do your song, we're going to do this song. I said, what song we doing, Jerry? And he said, never you mind, son. You just pay attention. Yeah. And so he finished half of the Jack Daniels, and he goes, brrr, and he goes, heartache number one was when you left me.
Oh, yeah.
And it was, it is. It's beautiful.
It's incredible.
And Mike Kerb said, Ronnie, you know the quintessential jewel that's on your album is the one with you and Jerry Lee. On my album is me and Jack Scott, Burning Bridges, who just passed away.
Ah, that's right.
Me and Wayne Newton. I know that's a weird.
Love Wayne Newton.
I do too.
We've worked with Wayne Newton. We love Wayne.
Me and Bobby Vinton doing Blue Velvet.
She wore blue.
Oh, I love that song.
Velvet.
Yes.
Yeah, I love that song.
And then me and George Jones. I wrote this song.
I don't know that person. The thing is.
So I wrote this song called One Big Family, and with two friends of mine, Mike Reed and Troy Seals.
Two of the best songwriters in the world.
Yeah, exactly. So George Jones starts it off. Eddie Arnold does second line. Farron Young the third.
What?
Roy Acuff, Little Jimmy Dickens.
Is this available yet?
No, not yet.
That's coming out, though, on Spotify and all the things we can get it?
Exactly. But the single I rewrote, do y'all remember this? This is my new single coming out on Curb. Because on March the 25th, I just turned 70 years young.
Woo! Yes.
And I feel like an 18-year-old, but I don't want one. Last thing I want to do is raise another kid. No, thank you. But anyway. But anyway, so I never will forget. I heard this song in 74. If you believe in forever, then life is just a one-night stand. If there's a rock and roll heaven, well, I changed it. If there's a country heaven, then you know they got a hell of a band.
Yes.
So I changed it, and the first person I put in there was my friend Conway Twitty.
I was just going to say about Conway.
Conway gave us "Hello, Darling," and Patsy hooked us all on crazy. So I called my friend Bill Medley, the Righteous Brothers. I said, Bill,
love him,
would you sing on this song with me? And he goes, well, what is it? I sent it to him. 3 minutes later, after he listened to it, he goes, Ronnie McDowell, you have a hit, and I'm going to sing on it.
Oh, my goodness.
And he sang this line. And the possum, well, he stopped loving her today.
Yes.
So I can't wait till y'all hear that.
I cannot wait.
Awesome. Yes. Yeah.
Well, you mentioned Conway Twitty, actually another Hendersonviller, lived right up the street from me, and one of the greatest artists, definitely one of the greatest artists of all time. You had a great relationship with Conway.
In 1977, when I was right in the middle of The King Is Gone, I was on the road with Miss Teenage America. You don't know this, but I'm going to tell you. So I'm out there on the road with her. She looked like a little Cupid doll. She was the prettiest thing I ever seen in my life. Her name was Jessica James. So
close to Jarrett James.
So one night after the show, I said, is that your real name? She goes, no, my name is Kathy Twitty. I said, you're kidding me. She goes, Conway's my dad. I said,
oh my goodness.
I would give my eye teeth to meet your dad. She said, will you come to the office Monday morning? I went in there, just right down the road. And I walked in, and he was standing there. And in 1977, I won't tell y'all, Conway Twitty, I'm not just telling y'all, and I'm all boy, I ain't into that Brokeback Mountain stuff. Conway Twitty stood up, and he goes, how would you like to open up my show, son? And I said, well, twist my arm, and I did for 8 years.
Wow.
That's a God's
great story. Relationship.
Yeah.
And how cool is this? You, was amazing how y'all pulled this off. Y'all took the amazing Only Make Believe, and you redid it, and it was a hit again.
Well,
y'all singing it together.
My band at the time was the Kentucky Headhunters for 8 years.
That's right. I completely forgot about that. That's right. They live in Hendersonville. Doug does, and a lot of the guys.
You're right.
But Doug does.
For 8 years, they were my band. So I'm driving down the road one day in the same car.
I completely forgot that.
Same car that I wrote The King Is Gone in. And this just came into my feeble brain because I'm a songwriter, right? First and foremost, George Strait makes me so much money. So, George Strait, thank you so much. But anyway, for the money. So, I'm driving down the road, and this came into my feeble brain. But it's only make believe. And I went, dang, up tempo. That would be perfect. So, I found Conway in a studio, Master Phonics.
Yep.
Him and Jimmy Bowen were sitting there. After we recorded it, I played it for him. He jumped up out of his chair, and he goes, boy, that's the way I always wanted Presley to do that song. And I said, you're kidding me. He said, I'm telling you, that's a hit. Put that out. What do you think, Bowen? And Bowen goes, that's a hit. I said, Conway, you got to sing on it. He said, you don't need me on that. That's a hit without me. I said, Conway, just think about this. If I go, take it, Conway, it'll give people chills. I talked him into it. This is a God's truth. After it got in the top five, my phone rang. Roddy, this is Conway. Like I didn't know who the hell it was, right? I said, yes, sir. And he goes, I've been thinking about it, son, and you did need me on that record.
Yes!
That's the truth.
Yes! Love it. We're getting some great exclusive stuff right here tonight. Oh, my gosh. If you just joined us, it's Don Ellis Gatlin Show. That is me with my incredible bandmates, Savannah Jack, all the guys. Yes, an amazing Ronnie McDowell here, folks, giving us amazing music and great stories. Ronnie, thank you so much. And I want to go to another top 10 hit right now.
Okay.
And as, you know what? This city I love. I love New York City.
I do too.
What was your feelings on New York City when you were getting ready to record this song? And like, how was it afterwards? I love, because New York's in the title.
Yep.
And I think the people there get misjudged sometimes. They're some of the most friendly people I've ever met.
Well, I got to tell you, in 77, when the King is gone, was going on, I was playing at the Lone Star Cafe downtown.
Oh, yes.
And Doc Pomus would come in and see me every night. Doc Pomus wrote, "This Magic Moment." And he also wrote, "Every Time You Kiss Me." And he wrote, "Oh, darling, save the last dance for me." So he would come in, and every night that he would come in, I would sing him one of those songs, especially Suspicion. I love that song. Yeah. But anyway, In a New York Minute was written by my friend Chris Waters.
Oh, Chris.
Who was a brother of Holly Dunn, who just passed away.
Yes, she passed away, yep.
Yes. And Holly Dunn was a wonderful artist. But anyway, Chris Waters wrote this song. It's a huge record for me.
Oh, absolutely.
And I love this song.
Absolutely.
I never will forget this.
We'll get some fiddle on this one.
Oh, I love
this. Jay Smith's bringing that fiddle.
And thank you. And I was doing this show with this soap opera girl. I didn't know who she was because I don't watch that stuff. But anyway, she came
in. I don't watch either, Ronnie. I never watched Victor Newman
it was one of those
Snapper stuff. From yeah. Young and Restless.
But anyway, it was a soap opera, but she was absolutely gorgeous. But I just told her, I said, "Well, I don't watch soap opera." But anyway, she said, "Well, I'm on One Life to Live." Yeah, One Life to Live. And she said, "Would you do me a favor?" And I said, "What?" She said, "You know that new song you got out in a New York Minute?" She said, "Would you just say Doing It for Me?" I said, "What?" She said, "You know that part in that song where you go, take my Texas time doing it?" I said,
"She likes the way you say it?"
I guess. I guess it was a sexual thing or something, but
I love it. I love it.
Take my Texas time doing it. What? You know, it's all about sex, you know, sex, sex, sex. But anyway, here it is in a New York
here it
Minute.
Is. Another hit from Ronnie McDowell, everybody. We're going to do the live version. It goes like this.
Since I've known you, you belong to someone else. So we never talked about romance. I think it's time I told you, Mama, the way I've always felt and what I'd do if I got the chance. I'd make love to you in a New York Minute. Take my Texas time doing it. I'd do you everywhere but wrong. Texas time to do it, and I'd prove that in my arms is where you belong.
On 1984.
So don't misunderstand me, I wouldn't steal you from your man, but if he's ever dumb enough to me, it's time to do it. I'd do you everywhere but wrong. I'd make up to you in a New York Minute. Take my Texas time to do it. And I'd prove that in my arms is where you belong.
Oh, play that thing.
Tony Hawk. Jay Smith on that fiddle.
I'd make love to you in a New York Minute. Take my Texas time to do it. I'd do you everywhere but wrong. Yeah, I'd make love to you in a New York Minute. Take my Texas time to do it. And I'd prove that in my arms is where you belong.
band.
Yes.
Wow.
Come on.
Wow.
Woo.
You boys did good.
Oh, my gosh. Hey, how about him for where you can't see you guys? John and Jared in the control room. Matt right here on the cameras. We have great people doing the show every week, and I appreciate you guys so much. I couldn't do it without you. That's an absolute fact. Thank you, guys. Unbelievable. All right. You know what I wanted to tell you? I forgot to say this. Did you know what song? A little trivia for you now.
Okay.
Do you know what song that you replaced on Older Women? When your song went number one, do you know what song you kicked out of number one?
I sure do.
You do? For real?
No, I don't.
I got it. I know.
What is it?
Well, you can walk out of me too.
Oh, wow.
Millsap. Wow. If you think I love that Ronnie Millsap. Right, you kicked that out, number one.
Well, I want you to know, I can walk up to Ronnie Millsap right now. And I'll go, hey, Ronnie, how you doing? He'll go, well, Ronnie, how in the world have you been? I don't care if I ain't seen him in 10 years, you know. You know, it's so amazing.
He's one of my heroes.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Me too.
Absolutely.
And what a record that was.
Now, I did get a song recorded. I did write a song for Ronnie in his career. So I'm very...
Wow.
I'm trying to get one with Ronnie McDowell. He writes a lot of his own songs. But it's not too late, Ronnie. Think about it. I got a bucket of CDs over here I need you to listen to before we can leave. Lock the doors. I said, no pressure.
I would be more than happy. I listen to everything
This is, people are seeing this, Ronnie.
Seeing what?
They're seeing what you just said there. You can't go back on that.
No, I'm saying that I listen to everything I get. I don't care what it is.
Thank you.
Sometimes
my songs are in that I don't care what it is category. I love it. Well, let's do another number one song. And you know what? This song there was an artist that, after this song ran number one for you, mm-hmm. there was an artist that came after this, and do you know who that was? There was the next number one after this song was number one.
I do not.
A guy named George Strait. Ron McDowell number one, then George Strait followed that. He did pretty good, too.
Well, you know, George Strait... like I told you earlier, you know, I wrote a song called Under These Conditions for George Strait. But I got to tell you, I'd written a song called All Tied Up. You remember that?
All Tied Up. Well, tied I'm all tied up, baby, tied up.
Oh, yeah. Well, it was at number two, and George Strait jumped over me and went to number one and kicked me out. But I had just written that song, Under These Conditions, so I totally forgave him.
I love that.
Because he made me so much money. So, again, thank you,
John. Another record I love of yours that you did with some of the boys live in Hendersonville also. That's a group, Exile.
You had this awesome
record where y'all collaborated on a song called Love Talks.
Yeah.
Y'all check that out, too. It's a great top 10 hit y'all did together.
You know, I love Alabama. They're all my friends. You know, I grew up with all these folks.
Yeah.
But Exile was one of my, because I'm into this wonderful R&B feel.
Yeah,
I love R&B.
They're terrific.
And so they had all this. They had just come off of Woke Up in Love with You. Oh, what a beautiful day. So I went up to JP and Les and I said, hey, would you boys do a song with me? And they said, do you have a song? I said, I do, called Love Talk.
Was that a Buddy Killen connection? Because I know you were working with Buddy by that time, right?
And then, well, Buddy and he was producing both of us.
Right, right.
And my friend T.G. Shepherd.
That's right. T.G. Yep. lives in Hendersonville.
Yep.
Yep. See, we're all connected. See that?
So what a wonderful, blessed life I've had. I tell everybody that I'm the most blessed soul on the planet because when I was a little boy, Don, every Sunday night I would watch The World is a Carousel of Color. And it was the Walt Disney Show, and Uncle Walt would come on and show us all these wonderful things. And I never dreamed that I would be a Walt Disney painter.
That's incredible. But
I've been painting for the Disney Corporation for 6 years, and so I'm just the most blessed soul on the planet.
As I said, you're hotter than ever right now. I mean, you could argue you're hotter than ever. This song... as I mentioned, went all the way to number one.
Yep.
Another number one song for you. This is—I always love this record. It's to me, it's a little bit different than some of your other ones, and it's got a little more the soul thing going on. It's a really great record, Ronnie. Great record. Was this Sony Records too? Were you still Epic, or was this?
No, this is Sony. This is epic. Yes.
Okay. Okay. All right, we're going to do it. Number one song, Ronnie McDowell.
Goes something like this. My bad reputation.
You're gonna ruin my bad reputation. They say my crazy days are through. It's all over town, I'm settling down. Cause all I'm crazy about is you. I know the bartender down at the Starlight Lounge, and he's wondering where I've been. Every Saturday night, he broke up the fights, but sometimes he let me win. He'd sure be shocked if he could see me sipping iced tea and watching TV. It's Saturday night and I'm taking it easy. Home alone with you. You're gonna ruin my bad reputation. Hey, with the good love you're giving me, I used to be a hellraiser, a heartbreaker, put loose and fancy free. You're gonna ruin my bad reputation. They say my crazy days are through. It's all over town, I'm settling down. Cause all I'm crazy about is you. I know the bartender down at the Starlight Lounge, and he's wondering where I've been. Every Saturday night, he broke up the fights, but sometimes he let me win. He'd sure be shocked if he could see me sipping iced tea and watching TV. It's Saturday night and I'm taking it easy, home alone with you. You're gonna ruin my bad reputation. Hey, with the good love you're giving me, I used to be a hellraiser, a heartbreaker, put loose and fancy free. You're gonna ruin my bad reputation. They say my crazy days are through. It's all over town, I'm settling down. Cause all I'm crazy about is you. Ooh, it's all over town, I'm settling down. Cause all I'm crazy about is you.
Yes. 1985.
Ronnie McDowell, everybody. Unbelievable.
I heard that you were going to let me take a break, so I go to the bathroom and you do a song.
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you.
We'll do it right now. I'll tell you what.
I know that's not planned, but.
It's not planned, but we can do that.
Thank you.
You know what? Do we know any of, do a little bit of Only Make Believe in honor of Ronnie and Conway? We don't do the song, but I love the song. People see us everywhere. I'm back on.
They say that you still care, but myself I can't conceive. I know it's only make believe.
We've never done this. Here we go.
My one and only prayer is that someday you'll care. My hopes and my dreams come true. My one and only you. No one will ever know how much I love you so. My only prayer will be someday you care for me, but it's only make believe.
Love Conway Twitty.
Love Ronnie. When he comes back, let's give Ronnie a big hand and hope things came out all right.
Again, this is the Don Ellis Gatlin Show. We're having a great time tonight. Ronnie McDowell is our special guest. Our studio audience of 300 deep, or actually five. Oh, I'm back on this. I got my little clip. See that, Matt?
Come on, man. Folks, on the lead guitar, he's absolutely incredible.
Thank you.
He is. Unbelievable. Guys, his own music is unbelievable. Mr. Tony Hahn, everybody, right there. On the drums, amazing drummer with the pretty blonde hair, Josh Berkheimer. This guy back here on the bass has played with some pretty amazing artists in his day, including tonight. He's also worked with the likes of Ray Charles and people like that, folks. Mr. David Abdo on bass guitar. Yes. On the fiddle, he's amazing. He's incredible. He's not singing tonight, but he does that too. Mr. Jay Smith. Awesome. Yes. Oh, yeah, yes. We do have a major thing coming up. We've been advertising a lot. Ronnie has been putting him on the spot. We have our major show coming up for Special Olympics on August 3rd. It's going to be right here at the Don Ellis Gatlin Show, but it's also going to be a telethon. And it's going to run from 6 to 10, 4 hours of music, live auction. Ronnie, live auction.
I got you, buddy.
Ronnie is an amazing artist, and he has agreed to have one of his, how would you say, pictures or paintings?
Prints.
One of his prints.
Yes.
Up for the live auction. Thank you, Ronnie. Get back up here, Ronnie. That's enough rest.
Okay. Yeah, it's prints, and you can have more than one because...
Well, take
you
what know, we get for the kids' Special Olympics, definitely.
Yeah, we do this a lot for charities, and, you know, the paintings... bring a lot of money, especially the George Jones getting a DUI on his lawnmower.
I'll take that one. I love it. Now, as we mentioned a while back in the show, you're tearing it up right now. You have a song that you went in the studio. It was actually originally recorded by Ann Murray back in, I think, 83, 84. Jim Ed Norman produced that record.
Yep.
Big record. But you've taken this... spun it your way, and I think it's more relevant now than it's ever been with what's going on in the world. And it's an incredible record. You're getting like crazy streams and YouTube action on this song.
Oh, it's a social media monster. Isn't that crazy?
I love that.
And I'm going to put my Ben Franklin glasses on because I don't know the lyric that well. So I changed just a little of the lyric. But not much.
I know, sort of, Ronnie, when you write your like songs, you write these great hit songs. You don't know how they go after you write them.
Well, that's true.
You don't learn your own songs.
But I promise you, I'm not getting dementia. But I do want to tell you this, and this is a God's truth, man. It is amazing, and thank you for knowing my songs the way that you do. Your harmonies are out of this world.
I've loved these songs. This is a thrill for me to get to sing with you. Again, a lot of people don't know this, but a Christmas album I put out a few years ago, Ronnie came in and sang it. It was one of my all-time favorite Elvis Christmas songs, Why Can't Every Day Be Like Christmas?
Oh, I love that song.
Ronnie came in and just nailed it, and it was what a thrill to. So now I've got to perform live with you and also been in the studio with you, and it's a great thrill for me.
Well,
Ronnie McDowell, everybody, right here. Everybody. Also, before we kick this one off, right now, I know you're working on the new album. The duet album is going to be huge. This song's going big. But people can still get your music right now. The Greatest Hits I saw is on Spotify.
Yep.
A great live album is available. You want to get that? That's out there. And that you did one of my all-time favorite songs, Cry to Me.
Oh, I love that song.
That album's available too.
Yeah, that's off of my Unchained Melody album, which was a number one record.
People need to go and download that tonight.
Yeah. Off the movie Ghost, by the way.
I love that.
Yeah.
Love that song, and you did a great version of that.
Well, thank you. And my friend Bill Medley told me not too long ago, he said, you know, Ronnie, I was driving through Needles, California. I'm not bragging because I don't like to brag. But anyway, Bill Medley, my God, when I was 13 and 14, I used to watch Shindig and Hullabaloo.
Shindig.
Well, the Righteous Brothers would come on. I never dreamed in my entire life that Bill Medley would be one of my best friends in the whole
world. It's crazy.
Yeah.
That's so, awesome.
How could I wrap my mind around that?
Had the time of my life. Yeah. I never felt this way before.
Sorry, you sound like Bill. Wow. Man, you sound like my brother Bill. Yeah,
yeah. Well, he's a big influence too.
Hey, me
big
too. Influence. And
well, this song is a big one. It's a hot one right now, folks. Check it out right now on YouTube and check it out after the show. Check it out again. The video of this song is on YouTube also.
Rock yeah, and the video just hit 50-something thousand.
That's awesome. Little Good News, it's called.
Yeah, Little Good News. And boy, is this song relevant or what?
Yep.
Wow.
Thank you, Ronnie.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
I rolled out this morning, had the morning news show. They were talking about all the trouble that's going on. Some senator was talking about the bad economy. It's gonna get worse, you see. We need a change of policy. There's a morning paper rolled up in a rubber band. One more sad story is one more than I can stand. Just once I would like to see the headlines say, not much to print today, can't find nothing bad to say. Because nobody robbed a liquor store on the lower part of town. Nobody OD'd, nobody burned a single building down. Nobody shot in anger, nobody had to die in pain. We sure could use a little good news today. This morning, I bet the news will be the same. Somebody takes a hostage, somebody steals a plane. I want to hear the anchorman talk about a county fair and how we cleaned up the air, how everybody learned to care. Oh, tell me, nobody robbed a liquor store on the lower part of town. Nobody OD'd, nobody burned a single building down. Nobody shot in anger, nobody had to die in vain. We sure could use a little good news today.
That is awesome, Ronnie.
Yeah, I love that. I know I kind of messed up some of the words.
No, I thought it was pretty smooth.
Well, let's do it acapella.
I say if you ever forget on the show, we always go and
no, let's do it acapella.
All right, last verse?
All right, yes, right, here we go.
This is the one you changed a little bit.
No, I didn't.
I'm with you.
No, I just forgot to read it.
Right. Nobody was assassinated in the whole wide world today.
And that's what I want to say.
Yeah.
In the whole wide world today. And in the streets of America,
this is what I changed, yeah. Instead of Ireland, yeah. All the children had to do was pray. And everybody, this is my favorite line, and everybody loves everybody in the good old USA. We sure could use a little good news today.
Amen. Yes.
And I like the way we did that because it's more poignant. So thank
yes.
you.
Well, it's a wonderful
even,
thing. Wonderful
even
song.
Though I screwed it up.
No, you didn't. It was good.
But anyway, you know, and no wonder why that song, as this Friday, even right now, I think it's almost 100,000 views.
That's incredible.
It was just 3 weeks ago.
Yep. But you've always had a great sense of timing and great, so you're talking about fate and all this. That's a great theme because, but you also have to have the talent, Ronnie.
Thank you.
You also have to be present to win. You always, whatever you needed to do, you step up to the plate and do it. If Dick Clark calls you for a big show, you're there and you do it and you execute it perfect. That's the key too. I know you're saying fate, and I do agree with that.
Fate is a hunter.
Yes, but you also
find you.
You also have to once you get that chance.
That's right.
You've
got to
execute. You've always done that.
You've got to be able to back it up.
Yeah.
And all these kids say, "Hey, what do we do?" And I say, "There is no secret formula. There is none." But you do have to be in the right place.
These grandkids today, you don't even know about them. Your grandson's here tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he plays on my shows. He plays the congas. I call him Maynard G. Krebs.
Nice.
But I got to tell y'all, this is the funniest thing. We were coming over here today. He just turned 15. He said, "Papa, are you nervous?" And I said, "About what?"
We're having fun. So we're having fun tonight? I told you we're having fun. I tell you what, every show, Ronnie, we do, we end the show with whoever the artist is on the show. We end it with their biggest influence. Yeah. And I thought you were going with this artist, but with Conway and Jerry Lee Lewis, I wasn't completely sure. But you went with Elvis, my favorite singer of all time. Yeah. And so we have we have another thing in common besides being on Epic Record at one time, all the things. But it was such a thrill for you to have you on our show. And we're going to end out with Elvis Presley, Ronnie McDowell.
Imagine that.
Number one song.
And everybody, they always ask me, what is your favorite Elvis song? And I was just with T.G. Shepherd. You know, he took George Klein's place on Sirius Radio.
I did not know that.
Elvis Radio. So I took, the other day, T.G. and I were talking, and he said, So what have you been doing lately? And I said, well, let me put this in perspective for you about Elvis. This does it. My 9-year-old granddaughter called me. She said, "Papa, would you come and have lunch with me back in February?" I said, "Well, sure I will." So I'm sitting at the table with, you know, all these third graders, right? And so I said, and I love aggravating kids. And I said, who's the meanest one here? Of course, they was all pointing at each other, and I said, who knows who Donald Trump is? Maybe three hands, I swear to you. I'm like, they don't know who the president is. I said, all right, who knows who Elvis Presley is? We do.
Yes, Elvis wins.
So this little black boy that was sitting right across, directly in front of me, he goes, well, who don't know who Elvis is?
Yes.
I said, you're third graders. So then this little boy sitting with Buddy Holly glasses on down to the right, swear to God, he stood up. He opened up his jacket and he goes, hey, Mr. Ryan, check this out. He had an Elvis T-shirt on. So,
wow.
My granddaughter, I know, my granddaughter got home and she said, she's 9, right? She said, Mama, I just got to tell you, Papa was a total embarrassment to me today. Mission accomplished.
Oh, my gosh. Hey, one quick thing before we kick the song off of Elvis is you've also been doing, so many great things right now. You got your own show that you're doing.
Oh, yeah. We're streaming live on Ronnie McDowell. This week, it's a tribute to my friend George Jones.
Yes.
And next week, it's a tribute to my friend, my mentor, and my second dad, Conway Twitty. The reason I'm in Hendersonville today, I didn't tell you this, but in 1987, he called me. I was on the road with him for 8 years,
right,
opening up his shows, and he called me and he goes, now here's the way Conway talked. He goes, hey, you need to get down here closer to me. The next day on Center Point Road, right down the road, I saw this 1802 farmhouse, 2 miles off of Center Point Barbecue.
I love Center Point Barbecue.
I do too. Hey, that's one of the last places I saw Conway. See, you don't know this.
I don't know that. We're learning a whole bunch of new stuff tonight.
But Conway, on my 29th birthday, he's come to my birthday party. He's spinning a 45 record. He goes, you know what this is? I said, it's a record. And he said, It's a guy that by the name of Chuck Howard Sr., but this song didn't work for him. You take it home and listen to it, and if you like it, you do it. It's a hit. I brought it back the next day, and I said, Conway, I don't really like that. And he said, then I'm going to do it. He did, and it went to number one. It was called Happy Birthday, Darling.
Oh, my gosh. Happy birthday, darling.
I know. Hey, I'm still kicking myself for that one.
You missed that one, Ronnie.
So,
that's a number one. Come on, Ronnie.
In Louisville, at the Louisville Gardens, he called me on the bus, I swear, and he goes, it was just me and him on the bus, and he goes, now, you've turned down a number one record. I found you another one. I told this at Conway's.
You didn't do it again.
I told this at Conway's funeral service because it's the truth. He said, now, I found you another song. You've turned down a number one record. It's about a man and his wife. And I said, all right. He said, I'm going to sing it for you a cappella.
Oh, jeez.
And he goes.
That'd be fun.
He sits right across from me and he goes, there's a lot of ways of
saying no.
What I want to say to you. And after he sang me, I'd love to lay you down. Remember I told you I'm all boy. I was getting uncomfortable. I said, Conway, that's the dirtiest song I've ever heard in my life. Huge number one record
for
Conway.
And you never recorded songs about sex.
That's all my songs were about.
What the heck? Conway's hand delivered me two classics.
But you got to remember back when he did that, I'd love to lay you down. You know what I told him? This is the God truth. I said, Conway, you might as well come out and say it. Come on. I'd love to lay you down.
Yeah.
He goes, it's about a man and his wife. I told you that. I swear
that
to God.
That is great.
So I told that at Conway's funeral service. I just had to tell everybody. So at Center Point Barbecue, not long after that, I jumped out of my old Ford pickup truck. Here come Conway spinning gravel. He jumped out of his brand new Pacer. He loved Pacers.
AMC Pacer?
Yes, those big old bubble things. And he jumped out of his car and he goes, funny, I should run into you tonight. I said, why is that, sir? And he said, I got a song for you.
Uh-oh.
I said, give me that sucker. I don't care what it is.
Yes! Yes! Not three strikes. No, three strikes.
No.
Oh, my gosh. Ronnie McDowell, everybody. What an amazing special guest tonight.
Thank
Here's a little Elvis Presley. Big influence. Biggest influence. Take it, Ronnie.
My favorite Elvis song and his favorite Elvis song.
Nice.
God's Truth.
Ready, guys?
Hey, I still feel 15 when I listen to this song.
I do.
I love it.
I'm like Paul McCartney. You know, he goes, when I hear All Shook Up, I'm 15 again.
Yep.
I'm the same
back.
Way. Swear to God. Sounds like Rich Cream. Really?
Kick it. Come on, go.
For you know I can't be found. I'm sitting home all alone. If you can't come around, at least please telephone. But don't be cruel to her heart, that's true. Baby, if I made you mad for something I might have said, please don't forget my past. My future looks bright ahead. But don't be cruel to her heart, that's true. I don't want no other love, or maybe it's just you I'm thinking of. Don't stop thinking of me, but don't you make me feel this way. Come on over here, love, you know what I want you to say. Don't be cruel to her heart, that's true. Why should we be apart? I really love you, baby, cross my heart. Walk up to the preacher, and then we'll say I do. And then he'll know you'll have me, and I know that I'll have you. Don't be cruel to her heart, that's true. I don't want no other love, oh baby, it's just you I'm thinking of. Don't be cruel to a heart that's true. Don't be cruel to a heart that's true.
Oh, come on!
I don't want no other love. Oh, baby, it's just you I'm thinking of.
been watching the Don Ellis Gatlin Show. My band, Savannah Jack, my bandmates. Unbelievable, guys. And my special guest, Ronnie McDowell.
Wow, good job,
boys. Unbelievable. Wow. We'll see y'all down the road. Thanks for watching, everybody.